Think back to our study of cycloaddition chemistry. There we learned that some cycloaddition reactions are forbidden, like the 2 plus 2 cycloaddition. Contrast that case to what we see with the electrocyclic reactions. All electrocyclic reactions are allowed processes. What differs, depending upon the number of pi electrons involved, is whether the reaction goes by the con or the disrotatory pathway. This is determined by the frontier orbitals involved, and for the unimolecular process of electrocyclic rearrangement, we're going to have to dissect that molecule into HOMO and LUMO parts. Let's see what the curved arrows can tell us about the filled and empty orbitals involved. Because this is a pericyclic reaction, there's a circular flow of electrons, and consequently, there really isn't a first arrow and a second arrow. It's hard to define what's the starting point. Since there isn't an obvious starting point, we need to focus on something, and one thing we could focus on is the fact that the reaction involves the breaking of a sigma bond. Anytime a sigma bond breaks, we think about electrons as being added to sigma star, so the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital might be the sigma star orbital. And if that's the case, where did the electrons come from? Well, this arrow shows that the source of electrons must have been a pi bond. So we'd have a pi to sigma star interaction, and those are the frontier orbitals that we're going to utilize. It may not be obvious now, but the interaction is a pi-type interaction, as hopefully you'll see, and you can kind of recognize that already, because if you look at the product, you'll see that pi bonds are formed where those curved arrows end up. Let me comment here that it would have been possible to reach the same conclusion that we're going to reach had we chosen to dissect this molecule in the other way. And the other way would have been to focus on the source of electrons as being the sigma electrons donating in to pi star. But let's take a look at the frontier orbitals for the case that I described, pi donating into sigma star. For the HOMO part of this molecule, we're going to borrow molecular orbitals from ethylene, so we're just going to shade according to the HOMO of ethylene, which would mean that adjacent p orbitals are shaded in the same way. For the LUMO part of this molecule, we're going to borrow orbitals from sigma star, and so if we began by shading this large outer lobe on the atom here, then we know that for sigma star, that lobe must be unshaded, this lobe must be shaded, and this lobe must be unshaded. Next, what we want to do in order to determine the reaction pathway is to match phases between the HOMO and the LUMO on adjacent atoms. Let's look at the left-hand side. So in order to match phases of this LUMO lobe with the HOMO lobe in the back, we need to rotate about that carbon-carbon bond, in particular this bond, by turning or twisting in a clockwise direction. Twisting in a clockwise direction will match the phase of sigma star to the lobe that's in the back on pi. Similarly, if we look at the other side, now let's focus on this large unshaded lobe. If we want to match the phases in the front, the LUMO, to the phases in the back, the HOMO, what we need to do is to rotate this again in the clockwise direction. Doing so, rotating about that bond, we'll take this lobe and twist it down so that there'll be a pi-type interaction developing between the HOMO and the LUMO. Since both of these twist in the same direction, we're going to be led to the conclusion that this 4-pi electrocyclic ring opening process goes by the con-rotatory pathway. Whether an electrocyclic ring opening reaction goes by the con or disrotatory pathway is going to depend on the size of the pi system. I'm going to work through the k is equal to 6 electrons for you here, but I'd like you to do the k is equal to 8 electron system on your own. You can follow my analysis in which we're going to again use the sigma star orbital as the LUMO. The HOMO is going to be the pi system now of butadiene. We know what the pi system of butadiene looks like, and the HOMO of butadiene has a node right in between those two atoms. And on the drawing, the line angle drawing, it would be between those two atoms there. We're going to match the phases for the first two atoms and match the phases for the last two atoms. That's the structure of the HOMO, and now the LUMO is as I've drawn it before. What we need to do next is to undergo a twisting motion to match the phases between the HOMO and the LUMO. So if we start with the leftmost atom, we're going to need to twist this in the clockwise direction. Twisting that in the clockwise direction will match the shaded region of the HOMO on this lobe with the sigma star shaded region to get a pi type interaction between those two atoms. On the other end, we need to rotate in the opposite direction in order to match the unshaded lobe on sigma star with this unshaded lobe of the HOMO of butadiene. We need to twist this in the counterclockwise direction. And so you can see for this k is equal to 6 pi electron case, on one terminal position, we're rotating in the clockwise direction, and in the other, the counterclockwise direction, that's the disrotatory pathway. If we started with this molecule here, and it had A's in a cis orientation relative to one another, the two possible products by the disrotatory pathway will either put both of the A's inward or both of the A's on the outside. We'll never get the product in which one A is on the inside and one A is on the outside. Now I want you to work this one on your own, and in the next webcast, we're going to take a look at the reverse reaction, the electrocyclic ring closing reaction, and do the frontier and orbital analysis for that elementary step.